برنامه نان گل سرخ رو نگاه میکنید. مجله اجتماعی سیاسی که به زبانهای انگلیسی و فارسی روی کانال جدید پخش میشه. سلام به همگی، من مریم نمازی هم.
و من فریبرز پویا هستم. در برنامه این هفته مصاحبه داریم با لیو اگبه، بنیانگذار جنبش اومانیست های نیجریه.
در ضمن در رابطه با انتخابات جمهوری اسلامی، وحشیگری داعش، ازدواج کودکان در لبنان، روز ولنتاین و بیبندواری، دیوارهای مهربانی و دکترایی در استرالیا در دفاع از پناهجویان کودک صحبت خواهیم کرد. با ما باشید. در 26 فوریه انتخابات جمهوری اسلامی، مجلس خبرگان و مجلس اسلامی، و خب مسخرگی همه این اینه که اصلا کسی به خودش اجازه میده که به این بگن انتخابات، وقتی که واقعا انتخابی در یه دیکتاتوری وجود نداره، به خصوص یه دیکتاتوری مذهبی که از همشون بدتره.
واقعا آدم خسته میشه در رابطه با تکرار این قضیه که انتخابات نیست و در واقع توهین به شعور کل جامعه ایران و جامعه جهانیه. و چیزی که اسفناکتر و ناراحت کننده تر، شو آدم عصبانی میشه دستش، که این خیلی عظیم ژورنالیست‌ها و خبرنگارایی و
متخصصین مثل حمید دباشی که بهانه میارن یه جوری توجیه میکنن.
آره، و تلاش میکنن مقایسه بکنن و بگن آخه این هم انتخابات، تو آمریکا هم انتخابات هست، تو ایران هم انتخابات هست، نگاه کنین اونجا هم پول چیزه، اینجا هم. ولی هیچ وقت صحبت از این نمیکنن که شما که مخالف رهبر باشید جرأت و حق انتخاب شدن و انتخاب کردن ندارین، نمیتونین این کار بکنین. رفیقای خودشون که از خودشون بودن، مرید رهبر بودن، یه خود مخالفت کردن، الان چندین سال توی خونه نگر داشتن، نمیتونن کسی رو ملاقات بکنه. و دازه اونا جز مافیای خودشون بودن. اگه حدس بزنین کسی که خارج از این سیستم اینا باشه چه بلایی سرش میاد.
و خود وزارت داخلی باید لیست وزارت کشور لیست آخر کسایی که اجازه دارن کاندید بشن و منتشر کرد. وزارت کشور یعنی چه ربطی به انتخابات آزادانه داره؟ مشخص از اول که اصلا یه جوک بیش نیست.
داره. نمیشه اسمش انتخابات،
واقعا نمیشه. و خب خیلی ها مثلا میگن که خب جمهوری اسلامی حداقل بهتر از داعش، انگار این کافیه برای مردم ایران، مردم قرن 21. و خب وقتی به داعش نگاه میکنیم، خیلی از قوانینش همان قوانینی که تو جمهوری اسلامی وجود داره. و خب واقعا ولی اخباری که داره از داعش در میاد، واقعا یه سری خبرهایی اخیرا در اومده که واقعا اسفناکه. مثلا یه پسر 15 ساله که به خاطر گوش دادن به موسیقی غربی سرشو بریدن، یا اینکه یه جوونی که نرفت به چیز نماز جمعه اعدامش کردن، یا 4 زن رو اخیراً مثلا سنگسار کردن. یعنی واقعا دیگه وحشیگری به حدش رسیده.
به طور دائم خبر آدم میشنوه، خبر اخبار رو میشنوه، مونده که به کدوماش پاس رو بده، به کدوماش عکس رو من نشون بده. و این جریان یعنی داعش تفاوتش با جمهوری اسلامی اینه که تو جامعه ایران عکس العمل مردم شدیده. داعش اسلام در قدرت بدون کنترل شده است، یعنی هیچ کسی اونجا نیست که فشار روش بذاره. و جوهر اینا همه یکی، عربستان سعودی، جمهوری اسلامی، داعش، اینا همه جریاناتی هستند که شما این هم عمل میکنن. تفاوتشونه که چقدر تو هر جامعه مردم اینا رو تونستن کنترل بکنن.
دقیقاً. و خب یک موضوع خیلی مهمی که ربط داره با قدرت داشتن به خصوص جنبش های اسلامی و این ازدواج کودکانه. و اخیراً در لبنان یک کمپینی هست به اسم کافیست، به عربی کفا نوشتن گفتن، و این کمپین داره سعی میکنه که علیه ازدواج کودکان عکس العمل مردم رو
برانگیزه.
و خب چیزی که خیلی جالب بود، یه ویدیویی درست کردن از یه عکاسی که توی ملأ عام داره از یه دختر خیلی جوان با یه مردی که مثل سن پدر بزرگشه لباس عروس پوشیده بود دختره و انگار اینکه مثلا تازه عروسی کردن و این عکاسه داره از اینا عکس میگیره. و جالب این بود که کسایی که از این صحنه داشتن میگذشتن، خب یه سری مثلا گفتن مبارک به مرده، ولی کسای دیگه گفتن که کاری که داری میکنی جرمه، داری با این بچه کوچیک ازدواج میکنی. و خب نشون میداد که عکس العمل جامعه هم به این راحتی نیست که قبول میکنن، اتفاقا اعتراض هم وجود داره.
جز فرهنگ مردم نیست، در واقع خیلی از مردم اعتراض کردن تو این ویدیویی که درست کردن. خیلی مردم اعتراض کردن و اعتراض مردم اینه که واقعا میخوان برن اون صحنه رو به هم بزنن. یه سری میگن این کار چه کار داری میکنی؟ جرمی، کار حق نداری این کار بکنی. و خود این یه تاکتیکی استفاده کردن که انتظار مردم و بحث در این مورد رو تو جامعه لبنان راه بندازن و به نظر من کار خیلی جالب.
و به خصوص چون میدونیم تو ایران هم ازدواج کودکان زیاده، یعنی تعدادی که اخیراً شنیده بودیم فکر کنم حدود 40 بیش از 40 هزار در سال 2014 بود که زیر سن 15 سالگی ازدواج کردن.
این در رابطه با ایران، این
ایران بود و در فکر کنم آمار جهانی هم اینه که 15 میلیون دختر هر سال زیر سن 18 سالگی دارن ازدواج میکنن، که واقعا اسفناکه. تأثیری که روی زندگی کودک داره اصلا قابل تصور نیست. و به عنوان اخبار آخر، به عنوان اخبار خوب اینه که دیوارای مهربانی که شنیدین در ایران که هستش و مورد استقبال زیادی قرار گرفتن، و خب در افغانستان و پاکستان هم این دیوارها الان هستن و مردم ازشون دارن استقبال میکنن.
و خیلی جالبه این حس همکاری و همبستگی و محبت نسبت به آدما توی شرایطی که دولت‌های اسلامی جنت مرتجع ارزش برای زندگی انسان‌ها قائل نیستن رشد می‌کنه و مردم احساس می‌کنن نیاز دارن به این قضیه. و گسترش این در افغانستان و پاکستان واقعا مژده خیلی خوبی، در عین حال که از وضعیت بد خبر میده و در عین حال برای حرکت و همبستگی مردم برای کمک به همدیگر رو نشون میده و مژده و خبر خیلی خوبی.
هفته پیش روز ولنتاین بود، روز عشق، و خب خیلی ها داشتن این روز رو جشن می گرفتن به غیر از جریانات دست راستی مذهبی و دولت های مذهبی مثل جمهوری اسلامی. هرچی که مردم رو شاد می کنه اینا رو ناراحت می کنه.
امسال به خصوص مثل یه کنسرت سیمفونی تو تمام کشورهای اسلام زده و جنت که جایی که جنت راست هستن مثل هندوی هندو گفتن که این کارو نکنیم، با هم شروع کردن چیز کردن. یه مولانای احمق توی پاکستان گفت مصاحبه رادیو کرده بود، گفته که کسی حق نداره این کارو بکنه بخاطر که مبنای قانونی نداره ولنتاین. مثل که آدم نگاه میکنم ببینن که قانون بند 3 گفته که ولنتاین میتونه انجام.
ایشون هم گفته بود که ولنتاین دی، روز ولنتاین، روز بیخودیه. اتفاقا خودشون بی خودن، قانونهای خودشون بی خوده، ولی جشن گرفتن عشق هیچ وقت نمیتونه بی خود باشه. مدتی پیش با لیو ایگوه که بنیانگذار اومانیستای نایجیریا هست صحبت کردم در یک کنفرانسی در آلمان، همدیگر رو دیدیم. واقعا حرفای خیلی جالبی میزنه. با ما باشید و این مصاحبه رو نگاه کنید. مرسی. Hello Leo, welcome to the program. I wanted to ask you about, you know, Christianity's role in Nigeria and the issue of witchcraft in particular.
Yeah, Christianity's role is is on one part reinforcing the belief in witchcraft, and another part presenting itself as a solution. Yes, so we have a little bit of a complex situation there, but at the end of it all, Christianity is actually part of the problem. The early missionaries that came, that evangelized in Nigeria and in many parts of Africa, They did not emphasize so much on witchcraft, because of course they were not Nigerians, they were not Africans. So, and they looked down on the cultural and religious beliefs of the people. So, and people have been using this as a way to say Christianity is the missionary Christianity did not support witchcraft. It's not true. They didn't even understand it in the first place. And they looked down on Nigerians and Africans as people with somehow primitive practices. So, but what happens is that the witchcraft narrative is part of Christianity too. So when the missionaries now left and all that, so local pastors and priests, they now took over the management of Christianity. So they now discovered some kind of commonality between Christian texts and, of course, the traditional beliefs. So that's how the reinforcement, we come about the reinforcement. And it's now difficult to untangle because the priests and pastors are presenting themselves as people who have the power to identify and remove, you know, witchcraft, spirit, whatever that means. So, and they have a way of turning every problem people have, giving it a kind of, using the idiom of witchcraft to interpret it. Because when they interpret it that way, they will now make you to understand, come to my church and I will deliver you. And those things that don't happen without people spending money and without people subjecting people to torture, inhuman and degrading treatment. And also inciting people by equipping them with that kind of narrative to go home and identify such problem and sometimes perform deliverance on themselves. So sometimes people who can't take their children to these churches, they can say, yes, this is witchcraft. They will now have to torture that child. And sometimes the people they torture are weak members of the society. Many of them don't even know. And some of them are forced to accept that they are witches. Because, I mean, you are being told this by somebody more powerful, more learned, and someone who's supposed to guide you. So this is how we got into this vicious circle, and this is how Christianity is actually part of the problem and not the solution.
I mean, you hear some real horror stories of the treatment of people who've been considered witches, even children. Can you explain a bit about that?
Yeah, I think that the stories, there's so many, because I have been involved in a lot, for some time now, in trying to rescue some of the children. And there were some children. They will be kept in a room, and they'll be flogging them. Sometimes they use machete on them, you know, not actually machete as in this, they use the side, because just to make them feel the pain, you know, and make them cry. Sometimes they drive them out of the room in the night, and some of them have to roam the streets. Some of them have to trek distances. Some of them have to sleep in the bush. So, and because there is a belief that torture, trial by ordeal, is a way to get the demon or to get the witchcraft out of people. So sometimes some of them starve them. You know, they keep them, they chain them, they put them on chains, and they chain them and they don't give them food, you know. So this is a way to get the child either to confess or to stop that thing they have interpreted as witchcraft. Some of them, we have had cases, we had a pour gasoline, you know, on them, yeah, and just throw them out. So it is difficult to capture the kind of torture, because this thing happens to children, and this thing happens behind the wall of silence, you know. And again, also believe, because when it's happening in an environment, people don't want to get involved, because they think that the witchcraft could also affect them. So they don't want to get involved in it. So the treatment they give them, I mean, is so horrible. Sometimes they just send the children out. There was a child I rescued that was around 8 years old. She was driven out and she was sleeping in the market, you know, when I came to the village. So when I came to that village, they told me that one man came and took the girl and is sleeping with the girl. I mean, a girl of eight to 9 years. So I was shocked. So they said that nobody wanted to go and take the child, because you can't take a child, they say, is a child witch. You can't take the child to your family, because the belief is that it could infect the family and destroy the family. So there is this kind of people harden their feelings and conscience towards them. They don't want to care for them. So I rescued this child, handed the child over to the government. Then the government took the child back to the father, and the father sent the child away again. And the child now went back to that same man again. So I came back to the community. They told me the child had gone back to the man and all that. We had to go back for the second time and rescue this child. So it is difficult. The children have a lot of very horrifying stories of what they go through. But let us not forget that these are those who survived. Those who survive to tell their story. And as kids, there are people who didn't survive to tell their story. And for their sake, that is why the little information we get and the situations we have, we're doing our best to see that, you know, the people who are behind it, that's the problem. The pastors, the spiritualists, the traditional medicine men and women, and parents also who have this belief and who go from one church to the other, looking for pastors to come and give them spiritual solutions to their problems, they are part of the problem. So by challenging them, by, you know, holding them to account, I hope that we can, you know, at least reduce, you know, the suffering and eventually eradicate the problem.
Do you think there is hope to eradicate it?
Yes, there is. There is. You see, there is hope. I don't think it's a hopeless situation, because even when we traveled to one village in Akwa Ibom State, we met one family that was that been trying to take care of the children, but there were many. There were around four or five, and this is a poor family. You know, they have very little income. So when they saw us, they said, they have been looking out for people who could come around and help them handle this. There are people who are, who have this feeling for these children, who like to take care of them, but they are not sometimes given the opportunity. They don't have the support. So I think that if we're able to go out, keep speaking out, the little people who are interested in taking care of these children, who understand the scale of the problem, the scale of the abuse they go through, will form a groundswell and a critical mass, and I will be able to, you know, get the problem stopped eventually.
You mentioned something interesting in your talk about how Africa has this image that it's all superstition and religion, but there's atheism and free thought there as well. Explain that.
Yes, yeah, you know, because when you read the literature, when you read a lot of literature on witchcraft or religion, there's always this brush. You know, they used to paint all, every African or the African continent. Yeah, it's deeply religious, it's deeply magical. And in fact, if you read the early anthropologists like Levi Brew, they try to see Africans as savages, and their thinking is magical. They don't reason, you know. And, you know, yes, if you are coming from outside the culture, there's a tendency for you to frame, you know, the thinking of a particular people in a way. Because number one, you don't understand them. And number two, you are using the yardstick of your own culture to judge another culture. Okay, but meanwhile, these are also people who believe in Jesus, who believe in that God can turn into wafers and you can eat wafers and drink blood. I mean, they came with a more ridiculous, a more absurd belief, and they came to Africa and judged their own as barbaric and primitive. And at the end of the day, the problem we're having today is because they left a primitive belief, or what they think is primitive, they try to remove it and replace it with another primitive and superstitious belief. So by saying that, it doesn't mean that we didn't have rational-oriented people in the West. Or we didn't have rational-oriented people in Africa too. We had them, you know, but of course they were not giving a voice and all that. So today we are trying to make sure that people who are non-religious, people who are critical of witchcraft or magic and who live in Africa, they are given a voice, and their voices are heard. Because right now, like now, if you look at the northern Nigeria where we're having this problem, everybody might think that every Muslim there is a Boko Haram member, or every person living there believes in what Boko Haram is to. It's not true. There are people who don't believe in what Boko Haram that way. There are people who don't, there are Muslims who are critical of some of the beliefs. There are something what I call cultural Muslims, there are what I call Allah Muslims, there are what I call just religious Muslims and all that. There are so many different types of people, depending on how they want to really express themselves. But sometimes they paint them with the same brush. So I think that there are critical, rational, skeptically oriented people in the continent, and they should be given a voice. They should be given a voice, because sometimes by giving them a voice, we understand how diverse, you know, these places are. And it can also help us in our efforts, particularly if we want to address problems related to religion, superstition, or fanaticism.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
امیدوارم از مصاحبه با لیو ایگو خوشتون اومده باشه. به نظرم واقعا مسائل مهمی رو مطرح میکنه در رابطه با نقش کلیسا و کلا نقش مذهب در نقض حقوق پایه کودکان. و خب اخیراً در اخبار یک داستانی بوده در رابطه یه بچه 2 ساله که 8 ماه الان در خیابون زندگی میکنه به خاطر اینکه مادر پدرش بیرونش کردن، فکر کردن جادوگره و بیرونش کردن، و این بچه تنهایی مواظب خودش بوده به خاطر اینکه خیلی ها میترسن کمک کنن و دخالت کنن. و اخیراً یک زن دانمارکی که اونجا در یه سازمان دفاع از حقوق کودکان فعالیت میکنه، این بچه رو پیدا کرده و بعد بردتش و کمکش کرده، وگرنه تو خیابون داشت ولگرد بود این بچه 2 ساله.
دقیقاً. و لیو به این مسئله و خودش جزء سازماندهان حقوق و نجات کودکان در این عرصه اشاره میکنه. نکته جالبی رو که مطرح میکنه و نشون میده چقدر این رابطه نقض حقوق کودک مستقیما با دستگاه مذهب وصله، و اون کسی که میاد انگوش میذاره روی کودکان و اعضای خانواده میگه اینا جن گرفتن یا جادو شدن، خودش هم در همون لحظه 5 دقیقه بعد میاد میگه خب من به عنوان کسی که میتونم شما نجات بدم، در ازای پرداخت مقداری پول این کار میکنیم. و این فساد مذهبی رو خیلی قشنگ نشون میده. یه نکته دیگر رو که به نظر من مطرح میکنه لیو مسئله اینه که هستن کسایی که میخوان چیز بکنن، کمک بکنن، از این قضیه کودک‌ها رو نجات بدن، ولی سازمان و قدرتش رو توی بعضی کشورها ندارن و این توی قدرت دستگاه مذهبی رو نشون میده. ولی کسی که میتونه اینا رو نجات بده واقعا جنبش روشنفکری غیر مذهبی و غیره است.
دقیقاً. لحظه زیبای این هفته در رابطه با تعدادی از دکترایی هستند که در استرالیا اعتراض کردند به وضعیت کودکان پناهنده در اون کشور. یک بچه‌ای هست به نام بیبی آشا، بچه آشا که رفته بود بیمارستان به خاطر نیازهایی که داشت، بچه‌ای که تو خود استرالیا به دنیا اومده به مادر پدرایی که پناهندن. و این دکترها این بچه که مدارا شده گفتن، خب دولت گفته خب این بچه باید برگرده به بازداشتگاه ناورا، که دکترها اعتراض کردن و گفتن که ما این بچه رو نمیفرستیم به بازداشتگاه ناورا به خاطر اینکه این بازداشتگاه نقض پایه حقوق کودکه
و بچه رو توی بیمارستان نگه داشتن و حاضر نیستن بچه رو مرخصی بدن از بیمارستان بیاد بیرون. و این یه جنبش رو توی استرالیا رو انداخته و مردم در دفاع از حقوق کودک، دفاع از حقوق پناهندگان بر علیه سیاست ارتجاعی دولت استرالیا تظاهرات کردن و کمپینای مختلف هست، از مادر بزرگان در دفاع حقوق پناهندگان تا فعالین و مبارزین حقوق کودک اومدن و این لحظه باشکوه در واقع استرالیا رو به وجود آوردن.
واقعا خیلی خیلی لحظه قشنگ و زیباییه. به هر حال رسیدیم به انتهای برنامه‌مون. امیدوارم از این برنامه خوشتون اومده باشه. قبل از اینکه بریم دوست داریم از تمام دوستانی که کمک مالی کردن و یا هفتگی از طریق پاتریون بهمون کمک مالی میکنن تشکر کنیم. واقعا دستتون درد نکنه. و برای همه تماساتون و کامنت هایی که روی یوتیوب، روی فیسبوک برامون میفرستین واقعا ممنونیم و واقعا خوشحال میشیم وقتی ازتون با خبر میشیم. Anyway، تا هفته آینده، هفته خیلی خوبی داشته باشید.
Goodbye.
Mariam Namazi.
And I'm Fari Bospuya.
We're hosting a program called Bread and Roses. It's a weekly program that's broadcast in Persian and English in the Middle East and North Africa, primarily Iran as well. And it's also shown on YouTube internationally.
And we've been doing this since last May. We're coming up to our year's anniversary. And we've had quite a lot of fun making these videos.
We discuss taboo breaking, free thinking ideas. The Islamic regime of Iran has called us immoral and corrupt.
And that's why you need to support us. We are and the alternative voice in Middle East and North Africa.
Of corruption and immorality. So do support us. Here's a short video from Patreon that explains how you can help us with even just $1 a week. That's nothing. Support us.
Patreon lets fans become patrons of their favorite artists and content creators. It's different than Kickstarter because it's not about one big project that requires lots of funding. It's more for bloggers or YouTubers or webcomics, anyone who creates on a regular basis. Here's how it works. When you become a patron, you're agreeing to give an artist a tip of an amount you set every time they release a piece of content, whether it's a new song, a video, or a recipe. You can set a monthly maximum to make sure that you're always within your budget. Choose an amount, enter your payment information, and you're done. Becoming a patron allows you to view and post in the artist's stream, and in exchange for your support, artists offer additional patron packages, which might include monthly Google Hangouts, music production tutorials, pre-sale concert tickets, or anything they can offer as a way to say thanks. Patreon, empowering a new generation of content creators.